In today's video, you'll learn how to calibrate your miter saw so that your cuts are square and true. Calibrating your saw simply means to check or, if necessary, adjust the saw so that it's cutting as it's originally designed. Now, this not only needs to be checked on older saws, but surprisingly on newer saws as well. The first thing we need to cover before getting started is that there's two different styles or types of fences that come on most miter saws. The first is a two-fence system, like what you see on this 10-inch Hitachi. And that simply means that there are two completely separate fences that are not connected. And once you adjust one, you'll need to bring the other one into alignment with the first. The second most common type of fence is what you see here on the 12-inch Dewalt. At first glance, it looks like two separate fences, but if you look behind the blade, you can see a rail that connects the right side to the left side. Why do I bring this up? Because each fence style adjusts slightly different than the other one. So you need to make sure you know which one you have before moving on. I do want to quickly mention that it's very important that you double check to make sure that the saw is unplugged while you're making adjustments. We're going to be bouncing back and forth between needing the saw plugged in to make cuts and needing it unplugged to make adjustments. So please just be careful. All right, the first two things you need to check, regardless of what type of fence style you have, is how straight the fence is and how flat the table is. To check for both of these, you can use a good straight edge like this one here, or a good quality level. Just know that the straighter your straight edge, the better your calibration will be. To check the fence on a single fence saw, simply line up the straight edge and check for gaps between the fence and the straight edge. A great tool to help with that, and if you want to get that precise, is a good set of feeler gauges. A feeler gauge is a simple group of thin metal gauges that vary in size and are used to determine the sizes of small gaps. To use the feeler gauge along with the straight edge, hold the straight edge up to the fence and use a thin gauge to see if you can get it between the fence and the straight edge. To check the table, it's the same process, using the feeler gauges to get a sense of how flat the table is from side to side. I personally have never worried about having my fence and table absolutely perfect. Somewhere around 0.008 inches or 0.20 millimeters is just fine for me. If your saw is out further than that, I would recommend continuing on with this calibration process because by the time you get to the end, you might be satisfied with the way your saw is cutting. The other options are to return the saw if it's new, replace it if it's old, or look up online to learn the process of how to flatten them both. Now, I personally don't think that the extra flattening is worth it, but I'll let you be the judge and the jury when it comes to your tools. Moving on, to check the fence on a two-fence saw, simply line up your straight edge on each fence separately and check for gaps as before. So after you've made sure that the table and the fence is flat and straight, it's time to move on and talk about another important distinction, and that is saws with adjustable detents and saws without. For those of you that do not know, detents on a miter saw are used to quickly stop the saw at specific miter and bevel angles. On this double fence saw, the detents are built in and cannot be adjusted. And on the Dewalt, they can be adjusted by loosening the screws that hold the detent in place. Regardless of what type you have, the next adjustments are going to focus on making sure that that zero or 90 degree detent is perfect. Because if that's good, all the other angles will be perfect as well, unless there's something wrong with the detent itself, which is extremely rare. So let's look at how to adjust the miters on a two-fence saw. I recommend using a piece of test material that's about as wide as your saw can cut. If you have a sliding saw, I would use a piece that engages the slide function about halfway. For simplicity, today I'm using an 8-inch or 20 centimeter wide piece to test the miter angles on both saws. Before you make your first test cut, make sure that the wood that you're using has a nice straight edge on the back. Once you're sure of that, mark it with an arrow so that side always stays towards the fence. With the saw set to zero, make your first test cut. Using the square, check the cut to see how well the saw is cutting. It sometimes helps to hold the piece up to the light to see if you can see any gaps. You can also use your feeler gauges here to help check if you're having a hard time seeing. This cut is looking pretty good, but I do see a bit of light coming through on one end. At this point, let's check and verify what we're seeing on the wood here is showing up on the saw. To do that, use the square and hold it against the fence, of course, after you've unplugged the saw. Now lower the blade down, starting by the fence side, and slide the square over until it lightly touches the blade. Most of the time, it'll be the teeth of the blade that touch first if you're using a large square. So if that's the case, always use the teeth as your reference points on the blade. However, if you're using a small square on a large saw, it normally falls on the blade itself. So if that's the case, always use the blade as the reference point. You can use the teeth or the blade itself for calibration. Just make sure you're not on a tooth on one end and on the blade on the other, because most likely that's going to introduce an error into your calibration. Once your square is properly positioned, look and listen. You can see and hear the blade's teeth touching by the fence, but not touching away from the fence. Because we can't adjust the detent on this saw, you will need to adjust the fence itself. Because the gap was here on the square, that means the fence on this side needs to move back. There are generally two bolts that hold the fence in place. Because we are looking to move really one side, I'll loosen the bolt on the outside slightly, and then I'll loosen the inner bolt a little bit more. That way I can get the fence to pivot off the outer bolt. The key is not to get the bolts too loose, because you want it loose enough that you can make an adjustment, but at the same time you want it tight enough that once you do make the adjustment, it stays. Here's what this looks like. While holding the fence and the square together as a unit, I'll push the fence slightly away from me, while at the same time watching the gap close between the blade's teeth and my square. It's hard to use the feeler gauge on this 10-inch saw because of the blade size, but depending on your setup, feeler gauges may be helpful here if you're referencing off of the blade and not the teeth. Once your adjustments are made, tighten the fence slightly, enough to hold it in place, and recheck. We have to recheck because sometimes when you tighten the bolts, the fence likes to move. If you need to make a few more adjustments, that's normal. Take your time and dial it in. And when you're all done, tighten the bolts and recheck it one more time. Now it's time to verify the accuracy with another test cut. This time around, things are looking much better. Like I said before, if you adjust the 0-degree detent or the 90-degree, all the other angles will be good as well. But let's check them by making two 45-degree miters and using our square to verify that they are forming a true 90-degree angle, which these are looking very good. In case you're wondering, I do recommend these machinist squares. They work great, they're accurate, and to get a decent set is really not that expensive. The last step here would be to align the right side fence to the left side fence. To do that, you can use the same straight edge as before and align the other fence carefully. Again, making sure that when you tighten the bolts, that you recheck the fence just in case it moves. With that process now complete, let's move on to look at how to make those adjustments on a single fence saw. First step, make a test cut. This one is looking pretty good, but let's double check using the square against the fence and blade. As you can see on the 12-inch saw, there's a lot more blade to work with, and you can get the square to fit against the blade without touching any teeth, which also makes it easier to use feeler gauges if you want to. I'm noticing a slight gap here closest to the fence, so let's fix that. On this saw, we can adjust the detent. So the first step is to loosen all the screws that are holding the detent in place. I recommend loosening them all, but leaving two of them slightly tighter than the others. Again, that way you can make adjustments with the detent without it moving around too easily. Double check to make sure that the saw is still locked in to the 0-degree detent and move the square over tight to the blade, but not putting too much pressure, which could distort the blade from its original position. Tap the miter handle either to the left or to the right to align the blade exactly with the square. In this example, because the gap was towards the back, the miter head needs to be tapped slightly to the right. And because the detent is loose, as we move the saw head, it automatically adjusts the detent as well. With the detent set to its new position, tighten back down two of the screws. At this point, you can grab a large square, if you have one, and check the full travel of the slider. This is looking really good, so you can tighten down the remaining detent screws to lock it in place. Of course, double check your work and cut another test piece and check the 45-degree cuts as well. I did forget to mention that it's a good idea to double check your degree indicators. Sometimes those are going to need slight adjustments as well. Now that both saws are cutting accurate miters, it's time to move on and check to verify that the saw is making accurate bevels. As before, it's a good idea to use a piece of test material that is close to the max of the saw's cutting capacity. For the Hitachi here, that's around 4 inches or 10 centimeters. With a piece marked with an arrow facing up, make the cut and use your square to check how square the cut is. I've already known for some time that this saw was out, so it's no surprise to see a gap here on this end. This saw doesn't have an adjustable detent for the bevel, but what it does have is a stop pin in the back of the saw that locks the head in place. The only adjustment this saw has for the bevel is this bolt that adjusts either it in or out to change the stopping point of the head. Because the saw's head is slightly beveled or tipped to the right, the saw head needs to be adjusted to the left. To verify this, you can either use a square and position it flat on the table and then riding up the saw blade, or you can use one of these handy little digital angle finders. To use this tool, simply turn it on, set it on the saw table, and press the zero button. With that done, remove it from the table and attach it to the blade. What we're looking for is a readout that should be 90 degrees, but here that's not the case. To adjust the bevel of this saw, unlock the bevel adjustment lever, which is in the back again, and then with a ratchet, turn the adjustment bolts until you get a reading of 90 degrees. Lock the head back down and do another test cut. And everything is looking good. Because we made some adjustments, if you look at the dial indicator, you'll notice now that it's off. Sometimes you'll need to adjust those. And that's easy. All you have to do is loosen the screw, slide the arrow over until you read zero, and then tighten it back down. The last thing to check here is the 45 degree stops. Again, because this saw doesn't have a detent for the bevel, it has adjustable stops for the right and left 45 degree cuts. To see if those need calibrations, we're going to use our digital angle finder once again. This time, however, we're going to zero out the angle finder on the blade and then tip the saw first to the right. We're at 45.2 degrees, so we need to make an adjustment. And if you look on this side of the saw, you will see the adjustable bolt. Turn that bolt until you get a reading of 45 degrees. With that done, move to the left and do the same thing. Now, if you don't want to spend the money on a digital angle finder, you can always use your combination square or any other 45 degree square that you have in the shop. As with the 45 degree miters, let's check the 45 degree bevels using two pieces of wood cut at 45 degrees. Line them up and use your square to verify the 90 degree angle. With the 90 degree and the 45 degree bevel corrected and that the dial indicator is corrected, all the other angles in between will be good. Let's quickly move on to the Dewalt saw and see how to make those bevel detent adjustments. For the sake of time, I'm going to skip the test cut and go right to using the digital angle finder. First, zeroing it out on the table and then fixing it to the blade. Here, right out of the gate, you can see that it's off slightly and needs adjustment. If I tip the saw to the right, you can now get a better view of the bevel detent plate. If you look close, there's actually three separate plates. One in the center for the 90 degree detent, and then one on either side for the 45, the 33.9, and the 22.5 degree detents. To adjust the 90 degree detent, you'll have to loosen all three nuts, and then you'll be able to adjust the head of the saw to the left or to the right until you get a reading of 90 degrees. From there, tighten back only the center bolt, which locks the 90 degree detent in place. After making a test cut and verifying that the 90 degree is good, we can move on to look at the right side and left side bevels. With the level box now zeroed out on the blade, tip the saw to the right and lock it into the 45 degree detent and look at your reading. This side is actually looking really good, so we can tighten up the right side nut. Moving on to the left side, we can see that it does need adjusting. On this particular saw, we have an Allen screw here that acts as a stop, similar to the bolts on the Hitachi. That stops the saw at 45 degrees. To dial the number in, simply adjust the Allen screw in or out until you've reached the reading of 45 degrees on the digital angle finder. With that set, lock it in place by tightening the last nut. Again, because we already adjusted the 90 and now the 45, all the other angles in between should be good unless there's something wrong with the plate itself. And again, that's really uncommon. Lastly, double check to see if the other dial indicator needs moved after making these adjustments. As before, it's a good idea to make two 45 degree bevel cuts and check them with your square. Again, all these adjustments can be done with your square. I just sometimes find it very helpful and quicker to use the digital angle finder. Before we end for the day, here are four things to keep in mind. First, on larger blades, like what's on the 12-inch Dewalt, you may experience some flex in the blade if you press too hard. The idea is to press the square firmly against the fence, but not as firm against the blade. Basically, the softer the touch, the better results. In addition to that, you should always calibrate on a newer blade because older blades may introduce some errors into your calibration. Second, this video doesn't cover all the available types and brands of saws out there, but it does cover the process of how to calibrate a saw. So bottom line, you're going to use the process in which you learned, and then you may have to figure out how your particular manufacturer makes the adjustments. Third, sometimes you need a square to check a square. It's always a good idea to have multiple squares so you can check each one for accuracy. That's one of the reasons why I recommend the machinist squares, because even the inexpensive ones are good enough for most woodworkers. Now, of course, you can buy more expensive squares, like Woodpecker's brands, for example, but they're really expensive. I know a lot of you don't want to spend that type of money just on squares. And lastly, number four, the ultimate test for miters and bevels is building boxes or picture frames. Because errors in woodworking and carpentry often compound themselves, if there's an error in the first miter, by the time you get to the fourth miter or corner of the picture frame, the error will definitely reveal itself. So I recommend that you take the time to build some sample frames or boxes with both miters and bevels. Just make sure that each length of the miter or bevel is the same. You want to make an exact square or box. If you find that the fourth angle is not fitting as it should, you might need to recheck your calibrations. Well, I think that covers everything you need to know. If you have questions, hit me up in the comments or reach out to me on Instagram. Thank you so much for watching and supporting Training Hands Academy. See you in the next video.